Oh. Please stand. And sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. So you have your palms. Let us pray, Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Oh,
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone should say to you, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it and will send it back here at once.' So they went off and found a colt tethered at the gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They answered them, just as Jesus had told them to, and they permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him, as well as those following, kept crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit to share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for our readings.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. "The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame." The word of the Lord.
My God,
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
The Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were to take place in 2 days' time. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking a way to arrest him by treachery and put him to death. They said,
"Not during the festival, for fear that there may be a riot among the people."
When he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly, genuine spikenard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were indignant.
"Why has there been this waste of perfumed oil? It could have been sold for more than 300 days' wages and the money given to the poor."
They were infuriated with her. Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whenever you wish, you can do good to them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed to the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priest to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him,
Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?
He sent two of his disciples and said to them,
Go into the city, and a man will meet you, carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, The teacher says, Where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? Then he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there.
The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they reclined at the table and were eating, Jesus said,
Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.
They began to be distressed and to say to him one by one,
Surely it is not I.
He said to them,
One of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish, for the Son of Man indeed goes, as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born.
While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them and said,
Take it. This is my body.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
All of you will have your faith shaken, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be.
Then Jesus said to him,
Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he vehemently replied,
Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you.
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
Sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch.
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass by him. He said,
Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will.
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely."
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. And at this, they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize him, to seize me? Day after day I was with you, teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, but that the scriptures may be fulfilled."
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard and was seated with the guard, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging,
"Everyone."
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said to him,
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
At that, the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
"Prophesy."
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's maids came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
"You too were with him."
But he denied it, saying,
"I neither know nor understand what you are talking about."
So he went out into the outer court. Then the cock crowed. The maid saw him and began again to say to the bystanders, Once again he denied it. A little later, the bystander said to Peter once more, He began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know this man about whom you are talking."
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." He broke down and wept. As soon as morning came, the chief priests with the elders and the scribes, that is the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him.
Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of.
Jesus gave him no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, he used to release to them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was there in prison, along with the rebels who had committed murder in a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted again. Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder. So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in a purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with, and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage, and when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his sword, his cross. They brought him to the palace of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying, "Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said, 'Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him.' At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
'Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,'
which is translated,
'My God, why have you forsaken me?'
Some of the bystanders who heard it said, 'Lord, one of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
'Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take him down.'
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last."
Please kneel.
The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
Truly, this man was the Son of God.
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of the younger James and Joseph, and Salome. These women had followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having brought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, watched where he was laid.
The Gospel of the Lord. For the Mass, in the book that I use, the Roman Missal that I use, there's instructions for every Mass, the rules for the Mass, and we call those the rubrics. And for today, it's very specific. It says, give a short homily. And I promise you, it starts out short, but something goes wrong along the way. On Thursdays, we have a little class for some of the moms who have their children in our little school here. Our staff is in that little class, and we kind of got off topic this last Thursday, but we were talking about, what is it that causes a person to go from just knowing Jesus in their mind and just understanding Jesus and understanding the faith and just kind of coasting through life as a Catholic to becoming someone who just can't do anything without him. They must have God in their life. What is it that causes that change? We've all met people that have had that. We've seen it happen. Sometimes it's gradual. Sometimes it's very quick. But something happens. In the little class, when we were discussing it, one of the members said, well, at some point, that person realizes without a doubt in their mind and in their heart that Jesus Christ loves them and wants to be with them always. I think that's important. As we read the Passion, we encountered many different people. I mean, go through and count how many different people are part of this event in Jesus' life. This is one day in his life. And look how they all responded in different ways. Every one of them was different. If you were to ask any one of these people to tell the story of Jesus that day, they would all tell it a little bit differently. Not just from what they saw as an eyewitness, but from what was in their heart, where their faith was. Let's go through a few of them and just see what perspective they have. And as we do that, let us enter into it. Let us enter into the darkness of this moment. It is inescapable. We celebrate in symbolism this next week in Holy Week, but this is life. This is spiritual warfare. And as much as we would like to be the bystander, did you notice how many times they said that word? How many different bystanders there were? Whether it was before they had arrested Jesus, whether it was as they were interrogating him, whether it was afterwards as they were crucifying him, many bystanders. But by our baptism, we are not permitted to be a bystander. I believe that any Catholic who is baptized and who's been given a chance to know Jesus will not go to heaven if in the end we are simply a bystander. Look at the centurion. Just doing his job. Probably would just be a normal routine day for him as a Roman soldier. Probably was not very high up on the list. He'd been stationed in Jerusalem. But when he woke up this morning, he knew it would not be a pleasant day because it was Passover. It was a huge celebration. All the Jewish people flooded into Jerusalem for this day every year. And he knew that they despised him as a Roman, as an invader. But he had to keep order with the edge of his sword. And yet there he was, standing at the foot of the cross, and his life was never going to be the same. The gospel leaves it in mystery, but you know that centurion saw something that he would never forget. He is one of the only ones today who will say something truly inspired. Today, he was innocent. We killed the Son of God, the Son of Man. He would never forget this day. You notice in the Gospels, almost every time somebody is truly courageous, it's not a follower of Jesus, at least not up to this point. Jesus, when he's in the garden and he's with his disciples, and he loves them so dearly. They are his brothers, these apostles. He chose them, he picked them by name. And yet, he has to be very patient with them. Jesus is getting ready to die, and they can't even stay awake for 1 hour. Have you ever been in a moment where it was truly serious, catastrophic even in somebody's life? Maybe you're in the waiting room of the hospital, somebody's in the emergency room, their life hangs in the balance, and your thought is, I wonder where I can get something to eat, right? I've had moments like that, and I thought, I am truly self-centered. But there was something defective in the heart. Had not entered into that moment. There was no love. All of the apostles are going to falter, except for one. But Jesus is very patient. There will be a day when they realize that he loves them more than life itself. There are so many different people in the gospel today. In our men's group, we were talking about conversion, and we focused on two individuals who actually take prime roles today in the gospel, Peter and Judas. Peter, maybe you can relate to him. He's a bit clumsy spiritually, but you cannot doubt his sincerity. He so desperately wants to follow Jesus, but he's just not strong enough. He's like most of us as men. We try to act like we have everything in order, like everything's good to go. But really, when it comes down to it, we will fall apart until we know Jesus, until we allow him to be our strength. Peter is the only one who we see, at least explicitly amongst the men, who weeps today. I suppose we as men should ask ourselves, have we ever wept? Have we ever wept because of our faith? Those of you who have, you know what it means to follow Jesus. There's just something about us that must break down before it gets built back up. Simon's our guy, Simon Peter. Look at Judas for just a moment, and not to pick on him, but Judas is the type of guy that joined the disciples, but it never seems like the disciples ever really bonded with him. In fact, it seems like they knew there was always something a little off. It's like he took the faith, but was always trying to manipulate it a little bit for his own purpose. Many of the theologians say that he wanted to take Jesus' mission and turn it into something that he thought would be right. Jesus was so patient with him for 3 years. But today, unfortunately, you see it all brought to a singular moment in the gospel. Judas looks upon a woman who takes this very expensive perfume worth 300 days' wages. In our salaries, that would be worth about $40,000 to $50,000. A jar of perfume. And she breaks it open. There is this recklessness about her love for our Lord. And she pours this oil over him. And Judas is standing there watching her, scoffing. He was the money handler of the disciples, and he's watching all of that money slip through his fingers. In the other gospel, he is the one who is named as saying, "What a waste." Jesus sees into her heart. She understands. He's going to die, and at last he has one person who understands. Woman who came to him and decided to anoint him for his burial, symbolically. Did you notice that immediately after this moment, when Judas watches something so valuable escape his control, he then turns to the Pharisees, to the Sanhedrin, and finally decides to betray Jesus for money? If we're really humbly honest, we can understand Judas. We can at least relate to him sometimes in our life. When our ambition destroys our family because we become workaholics, because we choose money over everything else, we neglect our children sometimes, all for the sake of money. Jesus watches it happen, but does not stop him. Jesus will watch us sin, and he will not stop us. And so we enter into the darkness of this day. Who else? The bystanders. The woman who sees Peter, recognizes him, calls him out. Aren't you one of his followers? How many times we failed to live any differently than any other bystander? When you've worked with somebody for 20 years and they come up to you one day and say, "Oh, I didn't know you were Catholic." For 20 years, that person had no clue what was in the heart of that person. We were a bystander. Bystanders who are baptized will not go to heaven. Aloofness is not part of our creed. We must enter into this darkness. And our stories are all different. What about Pontius Pilate? Pontius Pilate, you know, history records him as being, like most leaders for the Roman Empire, savvy and a bit cruel. But we know from the Gospels that there is something that impacted him. Every one of the Gospels written says it. He is a man who is above feeling anything for a condemned criminal. Why would he stick his neck out for someone he's not invested in any way? You notice in our lives, we tend to only make sacrifices for people who in some way can do something back for us, who can give us something in return. But he sticks his neck out for someone who has nothing to offer him. He was impacted by this moment with Jesus. He knows there's something going on that's never happened before. He even defends Jesus. How out of character that would have been. The other Gospels describe the impact on Pontius Pilate as being much deeper. But in the end, he placates the crowd. We do the same thing too. We will placate our family when our family don't want to go to Mass. Our teenage kids rebel and fight us and say they'd rather sleep in or they'd rather just stare at their phone. And so we placate them. And we give in, and the face slowly dies. But we know, like Pontius Pilate, it's inescapable what's happening in our midst. Jesus is close. Out of all the characters in the gospel today, there's always been one that has stuck with me. I even remember as a teenager, we would come to Mass on Palm Sunday, and I'd be reading through the gospel, and they would get to the point where they would mention this one individual, and then I would be stuck. I would not be able to get my mind to keep going on with as they read. And it wasn't until the priest would say, "Please kneel," that I would pop back into the story. The person was Simon of Cyrene. I often wonder why I always get stuck with him in the story. I guess it's because he is the one person in the story today that is shoulder to shoulder with Jesus. Maybe it's a guy thing. Maybe this is because how we often show intimacy as guys, kind of this physical way of helping each other. But Simon's not perfect. He was pressured. In fact, he was forced to do it. He can't take any credit for it per se. But you know that his life will never be the same. As he grasped that cross with Jesus, and Jesus' blood is on his garments and his sweat and the dirt, and when Jesus would fall, he would fall because he couldn't carry the cross and Jesus. And yet somehow, arm in arm, he helps him along. Simon looks at all the people around, weeping, jeering. He wonders what he got himself into. And yet there's the moment. He looks into Jesus' face, 2 or 3 inches away, and he knows that he was helping the Son of God. You know that his life is changed. The gospel even implies, on some level, that he would come to know the disciples. He would learn to follow. We cannot listen to Jesus or follow him without loving our neighbor, without being pressed into service from time to time. I was talking to someone a little while back, someone who's in law enforcement, someone who has to deal with the darkness in our world in sometimes very dangerous neighborhoods. And he said, it's truly amazing how often he can come across a situation in which someone was dying. Maybe it was violent, maybe it was an accident. And the people are there watching and doing nothing. So you'd ask them, why didn't you do anything? And they just shrug their shoulders. There was no good answer to that question. Our lives must look different. And sometimes the Holy Spirit will press us into service, and afterwards we'll be truly grateful. I know that Simon would look upon this day as probably one of the worst days of his life because of the fear, the unknown, and yet he would look upon it as the most important day of his life. He would never be the same. Many, many years ago in my own life, there was a day that was kind of like this. There was something that happened right in front of me in the road, and I had to do something. I had no choice. I was being pressed into service. But later that night, as I thought about it, I realized that I was experiencing a type of peacefulness in my heart that I had never known, simply for helping another person. And I remember there was a moment in my mind that night when I thought, I think I want to do this the rest of my life. One random event in my life changed how I perceived the world. It was a seed. That seed was going to take a while to grow. But it was a seed. We all must have that at some point, a little bit of Simon in us. Now the reality is, perhaps, that we can relate to every single person in this story, at least on some level. That's good. But this week, let us enter into the darkness. Let us walk with Jesus, and let's let him walk with us today, here and now. Let's let him transform us. What is the one thing that we need in order to truly encounter Jesus? It's that moment where I think all of these people either did or should have had a moment where they realized they needed him. They needed him. Together we profess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, begotten from God, begotten from God, begotten before all, begotten not made, of the perfection of the Father.
Our King has entered his city, our palms and cries of homage fade away, as the words of the gospel tell the story of his suffering and death. Let us bring our prayers to the Father through the Son that he gave up for us with love beyond our comprehension.
For the church all around the world following the Savior during Holy Week, Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peoples of all races and nations who seek peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer mental, physical, or spiritual anguish, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a spirit of penance, reflection, and gratitude during these chosen days, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the gentle repose of the faithful departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who are in the hospital, for all those who work in our hospitals, praying in a special way for one of our parishioners who is very ill, Dan Pradera. For all of those who we know who need our prayers, for them we pray to the Lord. We pray for the victims of the recent shootings. We pray for their family members, for the perpetrators. For them we pray to the Lord. Lord and Father, with serene courage your Son went forth to die for us. Grant us a share in his strength as we bring these prayers before you through Christ our Lord. That my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took a bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Paul our Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. We just call to mind those whom we know who've passed away. And all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life, may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Together we pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, take away the sins of the world, grant us
peace. My brothers and sisters, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a few announcements. I'd like to invite everybody to our events this coming week, this Holy Week. The events are listed in the bulletin. They're listed in our Lenten calendar. Today we have the little white books available if you'd like to take one for your Easter reflections. Those who are participating in our children's reading program, the person in charge is not here today, and so we don't have the books today, but we will continue with it after Easter. Check there are new confession times or there are extra confession times for next week, so please look at that. If it's been a while since you've been to confession, please come. On Holy Thursday, we normally have time after Mass to sit in adoration, so we're reenacting, if you will, or trying to symbolically be like the disciples who spent an hour with Jesus after the Last Supper. This year we're planning, weather permitting, which I kind of doubt, but weather permitting, we're going to be actually outside in the Stations of the Cross area, which we will set up kind of like, if you will, the Mount of Olives. So please dress appropriately for that. We will spend an hour in prayer. On Good Friday, we have the Stations of the Cross outside at 3 p.m. Again, weather permitting. We're doing our Via Crucis procession at 4:30. This will be our first time going off the property, so we have a little route we're going to take. You're certainly welcome to join us for that. And then at 7 p.m., the Veneration of the Cross back in the church. There are donuts after Mass if you like to gather and not get blown away, but you can gather. And then also, thank you for your donations, and please make a donation if you have not done so already. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you all in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go in peace.
Thanks be to God.